amigos, una nueva edición de Auto 060. Seguimos, vamos a seguir hablando en este show del Auto Show Los Ángeles 2013. Ya la semana pasada tuvimos bastante información al respecto. Estuvimos hablando con el CEO de la Maserati, estuvimos hablando sobre los nuevos modelos de la Porsche, la Macan. También tuvimos la experiencia de manejo con el Mercedes-Benz B-Class Electric, el BMW i3. Así que una gran cantidad de información, pero obviamente un solo show no fue suficiente para poner toda la información que se ha generado en el Auto Show Los Ángeles 2013. Y en esta edición vamos a tener todavía más información. Así que bueno, sin perder más tiempo, we're going to switch back to English to talk to Avi Bassett Hefferman and Peter Valdez Debena from CNNMoney.com. How are you, Avi? How are you, Peter?
Very well, thank you.
We're great. I'm recovered from a week in L.A. covering the show.
I know. Recovering. Yeah, and this piece is just starting. Now we have Detroit, Chicago, and then New York, where we'll see you in your home turf there.
Yep, exactly. We start in with L.A. and go right through March. It's going to be a busy auto show season, I think.
Exactly. So since it's CNN Money.com, I wanted to focus the segment on talking about money specifically. And we saw pretty interesting cars there, and one that caught the attention of a lot of people is the $65,000 figure, which is the price for the most expensive Kia and the least expensive Maserati Ghibli. Which one would you guys buy?
That's tough. I mean, I have not yet driven the K900. I have driven the Hyundai Equis, which is sort of a close relative, but I haven't driven the Kia yet. I have driven the Maserati. I think the Maserati, I mean, I loved it, but it's not for everybody. It's a smaller car about the size of a Mercedes-Benz E-Class, but unlike a lot of luxury cars, you really feel the road, you feel the steering, you hear the engine, it makes a lot of really cool noises, but it's much more of a driver's kind of car than a lot of mid-sized sedans like that. The K900, the Kia, is going to be a very large car, a big sort of comfortable cruising type of car, I would imagine. For a lot of people, that might be a better way to spend their money if you don't mind spending $65,000 for something with a Kia badge on it, which some people might have a hard time getting.
Yeah, and to be honest, the K900 badge, that looks a lot like a Mercedes-Benz badge to me, the style of the letters at least. Avi, do you have any preference in those?
Yeah, actually, you know, I think the interesting thing that Kia is doing here is similar to what Hyundai did and trying to get into sort of the luxury market by going after that buyer that's looking for the value and the same kind of ride and the same kind of features that they might find in a BMW or an Audi. And the question really is, you know, are people going to buy something without sort of that brand history behind it? You know, some of the features that it has, luxury interior, things like leather and, you know, an optional V8, it's a rear-wheel drive. It'll be interesting to see. Personally, when I drove the Ghibli, I was not in love with it. It has a great sound, but it actually, after a while, after driving it on a rather long road trip, it gets a little tiresome. So I think, you know, I'll have to wait and see what the Kia K900 looks like and feels like, and kind of go from there. But it is an interesting entry into this field.
Yeah, I drove the Ghibli actually last week, very shortly, for about half an hour or so, and so I didn't have the experience of a long trip. And I agree, it's kind of I like the noise, but I don't know after a long time how it would be. And you mentioned, Avi, history and names and all that, and Porsche came up with a new SUV, a compact SUV, the Macan, for $70,000, starting for the turbo. I think the controversy of Porsche making an SUV is long gone since the Cayenne debuted 10 years ago. So this is a hit for Porsche, I think, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's a beautiful car. I wasn't really in love with the back end of it, but I really, really like sort of what I'm seeing coming out of Porsche. It'll be interesting because I think that they're putting a big bet on the Macan. You know, they're hoping to sell anywhere from 50 to 55,000 units per year, which is actually quite a few. You know, although the Cayennes have done so well, in 2012 they sold around 78,000 Cayennes, which is their biggest portion of their sales. And it really, you know, the question is going to remain whether or not people who own those Cayennes are going to want a baby Cayenne, the Macan, to sort of grace their garages as well. But I am really actually excited to get inside that car. I can't wait to get my hands on it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a lot of fun. I'm really looking forward to it. I think, you know, it doesn't offer any more seating than the Cayenne. That's interesting. Most companies that offer a smaller and a larger and smaller SUV, usually one of them has a third row of seats. for most companies. Porsche is not doing that, but I think the Cayenne is a lot of fun to drive. I think it's the most fun to drive SUV on the market today. So I think the Macan is just going to take that to the next level and be even more fun. Now, granted, you know, Porsche does tend to make a rather expensive product once you get all the options.
An option.
I think Autoblog just posted something. They went on the configurator, their online configurator, and figured out you could spec out a $110,000 Macan.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
So the options can make these things go crazy expensive. But I am betting you that there is not going to be any more fun to drive SUV on the road than that one.
I actually talked to one of the Porsche drivers, factory drivers, Patrick Long, there, and he has already driven it, obviously, and he says it's a lot more fun to drive than the Cayenne. What may be fun to watch around the city, I don't know if somebody is going to buy it, but did you see that you are buying Puma at the entrance of the LA Auto Show? Would you spend $1.1 million for that?
Yeah. You kind of couldn't miss that one.
You don't even know how to say it.
I've seen some ugly cars. That was possibly a contender for the ugly. I mean, it looked like a giant wad of used chewing gum with wheels on it. It was the weirdest looking thing I have ever seen. I'm not sure. Did someone actually think that this is good looking? It was just so bizarre. It looked like some kind of idea of a parade float.
Yeah, I guess somebody thought they could send one because they are making it, right, Abby? But I don't know if
they
can.
They're actually, I guess I was reading about it a little bit, and apparently it was cooked up by an LA cosmetic surgeon, They're basically building only to order. From what I was reading, they're planning on selling these things. And, you know, it is kind of refreshing to see something, you know, so outrageously different. I mean, when I walked by it, you know, every time we moved from hall to hall, made me think that it should have sort of a hot tub in the back or something. It was very LA. It was kind of perfect for where we were. And, I mean, at a price tag of $1.1 million, you know, we'll see. It's supposed to have a Corvette engine under the hood. It apparently takes a bunch of pieces from other cars, but, it was definitely a conversation starter around the hall when we were hanging out. So
yeah. I don't see you driving around that thing in New York for sure.
No, definitely not.
Okay, we're running almost out of time. We're talking to Abby Bassett-Heverman and Peter Valdez-Demena from CNNMoney.com. And so I guess all the audience can go there and see all your coverage, right? There.
Yep. You can check us out at CNNMoney.com. You go into personal finance and click on autos. You'll see all of our coverage from the LA Auto Show. We've got everything from galleries and videos and personal takes from Peter. So there's a lot of great stuff there, so check it out.
Yeah, Peter, the last question for you. Would you spend $499 a month to lease a Hyundai Tucson fuel cell, hydrogen fuel cell?
No, I probably would not. I mean, I think fuel cells are a fantastic idea. I think if it were easy to get to a hydrogen fueling station, they make terrific sense because you get all the benefits of an electric car with the refilling time of a gasoline car. It takes only a few minutes to fill up with hydrogen, but you have complete emission-free driving. But at $499 a month, that's a lot to pay for a Hyundai Tucson. I think we have to wait for the price of something like that to come down before I'd be willing to spend my money just to make, you know, the environmental statement. But right. I think we could get there, and I hope we do get there, because I think hydrogen fuel cell cars do make a lot of sense.
Yeah, it's going to take a while to see that, but it was fun driving it. I did a little loop on it. So thank you very much again, Abby Bassett-Heverman and Peter Valdez-Depena from CNNMoney.com for your time and for sharing your impressions of the LA Auto Show.
Thanks, Javier.
Thank you.
Este programa fue una producción de National Latino Broadcasting.